Here's the original Dustin.
I have to write down questions.
God damn it. Might not be a bad idea for Ludio. Oh, well, you can stop it right
now. Let's stop it at this point.
We will get to the actual interview part, even though this will be really...
Sorry, I missed a couple days. I'm just continuing my... Oh, crap, which page was I on? You don't mind if I waste your time, right? Right. 1 second. Somehow I lost the... I already read the next section, but I... Whatever, I lost the state, lost the video. So we're on page 18. But neither the branch office nor the four members of the judicial committee showed any interest in the kind of discussion I had proposed. They did not even comment on the conditions I had stated for having a meaningful meeting with them. In a brief letter, they just repeated the summons to the committee examination. It seemed obvious I was already judged in advance. A kangaroo court. And the trial I had been summoned to would only be meaningless and a macabre farce. I therefore chose to stay away from the examination, as was consequently judged and disfellowshipped in my absence on June 9th, 1982. Attempting to gain time, I appealed the decision. A so-called appeal committee of four new members was appointed. Once again, I repeated the letter conditions I found reasonable for having a meaningful conversation with them. The letter was not even answered. On July 7th, 1982, therefore, a new committee met for another sham trial in my absence, and as expected, and there isn't any record of it, or there isn't any record that he can get a hold of. You know, like, the whole theory of, like, legal proceedings is that everything that the decision makers saw to make the decision is known in the record. And then you can go back and look at what they decided and why, and make some kind of determination about whether it was fair or not. Or there is none of that in the Watchtower judicial shit. There's not even a record. No record. Nobody can know what happened in the meeting. In both instances, the sole judicial issue considered was, did I or did I not agree totally with the Watchtower teaching? The question of whether the reasons for my position were valid was simply treated as irrelevant. Go watch Deconstructing the Watchtower Judicial Committee. You'll see a lot of that. The guy actually cited the Watchtower as reasons why what he was saying and doing was okay. He brought up that the Watchtower talked about the trials that were at the city gate. They were specifically at the city gate so they'd be public. And then the public trial causes fairness. He brought that up, and he just told it doesn't fucking matter. I'm citing the Watchtower when I'm defending myself about whether I'm disagreeing with the Watchtower, and it doesn't matter that I agree with the Watchtower. As pointed out earlier, the conclusions arrived at in this work upset the central claims and apocalyptic interpretations of the Watchtower Society. The 1940 thing is crucial. Witnesses will tell you that they don't believe in dates. They'll say that the dates don't matter. They don't know their own religion. The religion's stated reason to exist is those dates. And it's still the stated reason to exist. The whole thing is based on 1914. We exist because Jesus returned in 1914. We're the only crazy bastards that know that. And we're the only ones that are doing the right thing after Jesus returned in 1914. Jesus not returning in 1914 because we made a mistake. Like, a mistake that isn't based on, like, just a different interpretation, based on real-world facts. We can't have that, so we need to kill everybody that finds out. Such conclusions, therefore, would cause some unrest among Jehovah's Witnesses, and the leaders of the society clearly feared that their dissemination would disrupt the unity of their flock. Their sheep! He might disturb the sheep! I was well aware of my efforts would be... I'd like you to notice that we, being a sheep, being sheepish... Whatever. It's like a pejorative term in our culture, right? Appropriately. Where my efforts being interpreted by the Watchtower officials as an attempt to destroy faith and disrupt the unity of the true Christian congregation that's based on complete bullshit! That was proven to be complete bullshit a long time ago. And who keeps screwing people to keep their bullshit true? But faith should rightly be in harmony with the truth, with fact, and this includes historical facts. Thus I felt confident the publishing of the facts of the subject at hand would not disturb the peace and unity among those who are truly Christians. The true unity is founded upon love among them, for love is the perfect bond of union, Colossians 3:14. On the other hand, there is also false unity, founded not upon love, but upon fear. Such unity is characteristic of authoritarian organizations, political as well as religious. It is mechanistic unity, enforced by leaders of such organizations who want to maintain their authority to keep control over individuals. A unity that does not depend on truth. The Soviet Union, the notion that people, if you just give us the power to run your lives for you, your lives would be wonderful, said the communists. When you make a claim like that, that isn't true, like definitely isn't true, you have to start screwing people to keep your shit true. That's how the Soviet Union went evil. They didn't mean to be evil. If you build your house on the sand, you need to do a lot of shoveling to try to keep your shit together. That's how it all comes about. If you have to defend falsehood, then you have to start screwing people. In such organizations, individuals relinquish to central authorities their right and responsibility to think, speak, and act freely. Since the evidence and the conclusions that are presented in this work overthrow the authoritarian claims of the Watchtower Society, the publication of this work may possibly be a threat to the enforced unity within this organization. But the true unity founded upon love among Christian individuals whose fellowship is with the Father and His Son, Jesus Christ, will surely not be affected by this, John 7, whatever. Thus, even if the prophetic claims and interpretation of the Watchtower Society are found to be groundless, nothing of real value will be lost when these dissolve and disappear. When the Watchtower dissolves and disappears, nothing of real value will be lost. So, don't think of it as losing your hope for the future. Think of it as gaining the knowledge that your hope for the future is just a bunch of bullshit. You're not losing your hope for the future. You never had it. You've gained the knowledge your hope for the future is a bunch of bullshit. So don't feel bad about it. A Christian still has God's word as a real source of truth and hope. Christ is still his Lord and his only hope for future life, and he will still enjoy Christian peace and unity with his Father and with Jesus Christ, and with those individuals on earth who turn out to be his true brothers and sisters. Even if he were to be expelled from an authoritarian religious system because he accepts what he clearly sees to be true, the parable of the wise king who believed extremely implausible things for no particular reason. And Jesus is going to kill you unless you believe extremely implausible things? He wasn't trying to get you to believe extremely implausible things. Expelled from an authoritarian religious system because he accepts what he clearly sees to be true, Christ will not forsake him, for he said, when two or three come together in my name, there I am with them. The answer to the question, where shall we go without the organization, is still the same as at the time of the apostles when Peter said, Lord, whom shall we go away to? You have the sayings of everlasting life. Fastball, the way. Where were they going without ever knowing the way? It is Christ's organization who has sayings of everlasting life. During the years that have passed since this research started, I have come to know, personally or by letter, a growing number of Jehovah's Witnesses at different levels of the Watchtower organization who have examined thoroughly the questions of chronology and independently arrived at the same conclusions that are presented in this volume. It's this book. Some of the men tried very hard to defend the society's chronology before they were forced by biblical and historical evidence to abandon it. Among such were members of the Watchtower Research Committee appointed to produce the society's Bible Dictionary, Aid to Bible Understanding. The section on chronology in this work, on pages 322 through 348, is still the most able and thorough discussion of the Watchtower's chronology ever published by the organization. Yet the individuals who wrote that article in question ultimately came to realize the society's 607 BCE date for the fall of Jerusalem to the Babylonians could not be defended. And it has no reason. It's not just that these aren't like two competing perspectives. There is nothing saying that 607 is the right date. Nothing. Nothing. Missed by 20 years, but in the debate between 607 and 587, there's nothing saying 607. Like, anything that would allow you to say 607 is, like, a correct date would be fuzzy. Like, to pin on a year doesn't make any sense. Like, there's nothing saying 607. Date for the fall of Jerusalem to Babylonians could not be defended, and later he abandoned it altogether with the calculations and teachings founded upon it. In a letter to me, he stated, this is from a letter In developing the subject chronology for aid to Bible understanding, the Neo-Babylonian period extending from the reign of Nebuchadnezzar's father Nabopolassar and the reign of Nabonidus, the fall of Babylon, presented a particular problem. Notice the ship in the Matrix is the Nebuchadnezzar, right? As just like, so this whole matter of Babylon, whatever, is broadly relevant. Nobody else takes the view that the Watch started, though. It's completely unique concept that the end is predicted. First of all, the notion that you're going to calculate the end of the world is kind of, yeah. But the notion that, whatever, when Jerusalem fell to Babylon starts the timeline to calculate when Jesus will return, they just pulled that out of their ass. There's no reason to think so. As Jehovah's Witnesses, we're obviously interested in finding and presenting some evidence, however small, in support for the year 607 BC as the date for the destruction of Jerusalem to Nebuchadnezzar's 18th year. I was well aware of the fact that historians consistently point to the time some 20 years later when they placed the start of Nebuchadnezzar's reign at 605 BCE rather than 625 BCE. The date used in Watchtower publications, I knew that the date used in Watchtower publications. So they got the date that Nebuchadnezzar, the date of Nebuchadnezzar's 18th year, they got wrong by 20 years. I knew that the 607 BC date was crucial to the society's interpretation of the seven times of Daniel chapter 4 as pointing to the year 1914. A large amount of research went into that effort. At the time, 1968, Charles Plager, a member of the Watchtower headquarters staff, was assigned as an assistant to me. He spent many weeks searching through the libraries of New York City for any sources of information that might give some validity to the date of 607 BCE as the time of Jerusalem's destruction. We also went to Brown University. These are Jehovah's Witnesses trying to find a shred of evidence to support the date that they're sure is right. Went to, like, looking for something to say 607. Brown University to interview Dr. A.J. Sachs, a specialist in astronomical texts relating to the Neo-Babylonian and adjoining periods. None of these efforts produced any evidence in support of the 607 BC date. This is a Jehovah's Witness who is charged with researching and finding a basis, searching libraries, trying to find a basis to where they can support their bullshit of 607, and he couldn't find anything. In view of this, in writing the article in chronology, I devoted a considerable portion of material to efforts showing that the uncertainties exist in historical sources. So now they're saying, we know our date is super right, so like everything that says it's wrong is just fuzzy. They don't really know. And if they don't really know, then our date that we just pulled out of our ass is definitely right. Uncertainties existent in ancient historical sources, including not only Babylonian sources, but also Egyptian, Assyrian, and Medo-Persian. Though I still believe the number of these points presented to such uncertainties are valid, I know that the argumentation was born of a desire to uphold a date for which there is simply no historical evidence. And no reason at all, there's no reason at all to think that that date is correct in any way. Came out of someone's ass. If the historical evidence did, in fact, contradict some clear statement in Scripture, I would not hesitate to hold the scriptural account as more reliable. But I realize the issue is not some contradiction of clear scriptural statement, but contradiction of an interpretation placed upon portions of Scripture, giving to them the meaning is not stated in the Bible itself. The uncertainties that are found in such human interpretations are clearly equal to the uncertainties found in chronological accounts of ancient history. All right, page 21, I'm at acknowledgments.